Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Joshua Berry, and I'm a senior analyst of chronic disease prevention at ASTO, the Association of State and Territorial Health Officials. I am joined by Aaron Bowles-Welsh, the current chair of the Tobacco Control Network Executive Committee and the Tobacco Control Program Manager for the Rhode Island Department of Health. We are honored to welcome you to today's webinar, State and Local Stakeholders' Role in Reducing Menthol Tobacco Use. Before we get started, I'd like to take a quick moment and overview logistics for our webinar this afternoon. You have the option of listening to this webinar through your computer speakers, which is the preferred method, or over the phone through the toll-free number and passcode available on your screen, and please do not use both methods. The webinar is currently being recorded, and a link to this recording and webinar slides will be sent to you later on as soon as those recordings are available. The recording and webinar slides will also be posted on the TCN website in approximately 2 weeks. We invite you to participate in this afternoon's question and answer session by typing your questions into the on-screen chat box at any time during the webinar. Computer and phone lines will be muted for the duration of the webinar. As you can see, we do have a full agenda to cover this afternoon, which will allow us to learn more about menthol from the perspective of a state tobacco control program manager, a local stakeholder involved in a menthol campaign and local policy successes, and also a national network representative who will provide some greater social context on menthol use. And we'll get us started with a brief overview of both ASTO and the Tobacco Control Network. So ASTO is a consensus-driven national nonprofit representing state and territorial public health agencies in the United States, the U.S. territories, freely associated states, and the District of Columbia. We are a leadership home, an advocate, and a capacity-building provider for state and territorial health officials and their leadership teams. Our members, the chief health officials of these jurisdictions, formulate and influence sound public health policy and ensure excellence in state-based public health practice. ASTO members and our key public health partners and 20 affiliate organizations represent public health leaders across state, territorial, and local health departments. ASTO serves as a resource to state health agencies and national and federal partners on public health perspectives, capacities, challenges, and opportunities to implement state-based prevention initiatives. And to provide a brief overview of the Tobacco Control Network, I will turn the floor over to my co-moderator this afternoon, Aaron Bowles-Welsh. Aaron?
Thanks, Josh. The Tobacco Control Network, or TCN, is an ASTO peer network governed by an executive committee that includes a diverse representation of state-level tobacco control stakeholders from across the United States, both states and territories, from Rhode Island to Hawaii. This allows the executive committee to represent the TCN members working in tobacco control throughout the United States. TCN is comprised of tobacco control program managers, additional tobacco control programs such as the Funders Alliance, and additional staff from each state, territory, and the District of Columbia. The partnership between ASTO and the TCN provides a valuable linkage to tobacco programs across the nation and assists ASTO in achieving the goals of tobacco prevention and control with an accurate state-level perspective. TCN established its 2016 to 2019 strategic map, shown here, to help achieve its mission of improving the public's health by advancing state and territorial tobacco prevention and control. Current priorities include engaging TCN members in the future of TCN, supporting tobacco control funding alongside national partners, and keeping pace with environmental changes in the tobacco use landscape with an overarching principle of incorporating health equity in all of TCN's work. It's now time. I'd like to give the floor to the speakers joining us today. Presenting first is Laura Oliven, who is the Tobacco Control Manager for the Minnesota Department of Health and is responsible for Minnesota tobacco control policy, media, grant making, and evaluation. She's served there for 3 years and has 2 decades of experience promoting population health and building healthy communities. Thank you, Laura, for joining today's webinar.
Good afternoon, and thank you for having me. I've been asked to participate in the webinar today, not only to share my experiences as the Minnesota Tobacco Control Manager and what a state-level official can do to address the harms of menthol tobacco use, but also talk about a specific initiative that we ran to advance and address this important issue. So we do everything from the lens of health equity. Across the state, our adult tobacco use rate is about 14%. But we continue to be very concerned about deep tobacco use disparities that are persistent despite the declining overall use. In particular, we have focused on menthol use disparities with a particular focus of our African-American population. So as I mentioned, the average percentage is 14%. And in our BRFIS for 2015, our African-American use rate was over 21%. When we dug deeper into the use of menthol, as you can see on this slide, we see a very high use rate, kind of a predominant preferred tobacco being menthol tobacco at 74%. We also view this as a youth issue and a strategy to kind of addict and allure high school students with 34%. And you can see that these are disparities compared to the overall rate. Just a reminder that everything we do has a focus of health equity here in the Minnesota Department of Health. And many of you probably have seen this, where we focus on implementing health in all policies, kind of expand our definition of health, but here in the Tobacco Prevention and Control, we really are focusing on strengthening the capacity of the community to influence their own healthy future. I also, as a tobacco control manager, and similar to the other 49 plus in the country, had to do a comprehensive tobacco control five-year plan. And I'm pleased to say that we did that. I did that with the two other funders in the state, which I'll talk about again in a minute. And that's Blue Cross Blue Shield Center for Prevention and Clearway Minnesota. So the three of us co-chaired it with an advisory committee of 28 members representing stakeholders. And you will see these are our kind of high-level policy priorities. And after price, which we know has the greatest influence on tobacco use, note the second and third, we call them bold steps in our plan. Now, really, these are combined. It's really about restricting sales of menthol flavored. Maybe as you'll hear in our next speaker, not everyone is ready, or the community might not be ready to initially do menthol, but menthol and flavored are really one. But we separated them for this purpose. So part of what I wanted to be able to describe is, as a reflection of the framework, the three funders convened kind of the chief stakeholders, and in a united strategy, we decided to address and try and help lead the nation in restrictions around menthol, the availability of menthol tobacco in the community. And the efforts that we're going to be describing today actually reflect Minneapolis and St. Paul, who began and led the way, and we'll have some excellent speakers who did the work on the ground, and the work that was later done by the American Lung Association in Duluth. And we're very proud to have three cities that have accomplished such bold policy change. So in 2015, our legislature was very focused on the impact of menthol tobacco on the African-American community. And past legislation required us to do a specialized grant through our statewide health improvement program. We created an RFP, a request for a proposal for $200,000 to implement new strategies and address the impacts of menthol tobacco specific to the African American population. And we did that with the way the funding was structured. We had to grant to a local public health. But we are very much committed to supporting and investing in community-driven strategies, particularly with menthol, where it's the tobacco of choice of the African-American community. So we require the local public health board to pass through at least 70% of the funding to go into the community to engage the community around those activities. We also chose a really classic public health approach because of the goals of our agency. And we wanted, we created some key activities in the grant that would forge those partnerships. We wanted to focus on some data collection in the community. We wanted to kind of dig deep and educate the community as a strategy. We were we asked for a youth component because that's very important. We also wanted to use best practice to anything we found out from the community. We wanted to go it to go back to the community. And, of course, all of this is for the purpose of mobilization. So I'm pleased to say that the grantee, African American Leadership Forum, conducted 407 surveys out into the community and went to where the population, the community gathered naturally. And the organization had hired a number of individuals called change agents, and they were able to collect all of this information. They also supplemented that with 10 in-depth interviews. We were collecting information on a variety of aspects of menthol use in the community, including awareness, perspectives, behaviors, cessation attempts, and where people got information when they wanted to know more or wanted to quit. We were able to assemble these findings into the form of an infographic that was later used widely. And one thing that was really valuable about this, it was a documentation of from the community, so of those perspectives and findings, and you can read the colored boxes. It reinforced many of the kind of our hypotheses or what we thought was happening. For example, the fact that the community was indeed using menthol. We were pleased to see, despite the widespread use, that there was quite a bit of support, 86% for further limitations around the availability. And note that they reinforced that menthol made it harder to quit. One thing we did learn from this that we had suspected, that there's a wide awareness and use of coupons and coupon availability, both electronic and in paper form for coupons. The African American Leadership Forum also issued a series of recommendations that actually were not limited just to classic restrictions on menthol tobacco, but called for minimum price, tobacco 21, reduction in number and density, and in fact, limitations on redemption of coupon and price discounting. That's Jean Nichols, who led the on the left in the, oops, what's happened there? Somebody else is advancing my slides. So the in the rainbow t-shirt, that's Jean from the African American Leadership Forum testifying. I'm not sure if that's Minneapolis or St. Paul. I think Minneapolis. And there is the joyous celebration upon passage of Minneapolis, which our next speaker is going to highlight how she achieved that impressive accomplishment. And as always, I'm available to chat, answer more questions, and feel free to reach out to me. And with that, I would like to introduce our next speaker, Betsy Brock from the Association of Nonsmokers. Take it away, Betsy.
Okay, thank you, Laura, for, sorry, Betsy. Thank you, Laura, so much for getting us kicked off with that perspective from Minnesota. So I will happily turn the floor over to Betsy Brock, who is the Director of Research at the Association for Nonsmokers Minnesota. In this role, Betsy focuses on gathering and disseminating research findings that can be put into action to both make meaningful policy change and evaluate the impact of existing tobacco control policies. So thank you again, Betsy, for being with us. The floor is all yours.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. Today I'm going to tell you the story about restricting menthol tobacco in Minneapolis. My partner in crime on this work is Latricia Vita, and she couldn't join today. So I will instead show you her picture. So here we are. Latricia works with North Point, which is a community clinic, and I'm with Answer, which is a nonprofit, and we work together on this policy with a number of other partners. So Minneapolis kind of did this in two steps. In 2015, the City Council voted unanimously to restrict the sale of other flavored tobacco products, so flavors other than menthol. They said that they can only be sold in adult-only tobacco shops. Then almost a little over 2 years later, the council came back and voted to remove the menthol exemption. They added a liquor store exemption just for the menthol part. And the policy is going to be implemented in August of this year. So just a little bit about our city. Minneapolis is the largest city in Minnesota, population of 400,000. There's really an increasing focus on health equity, especially at the city council level. Council members are really concerned about that and interested in that. There's a north-south divide in our city with a lot of the concentration of poverty in the north. And last year, the city council passed a $15 minimum wage and required employers to provide paid sick and safe time. And the council and the mayor were up for re-election. So both of those last two bullets made our work a little bit more challenging. So I'm going to talk about how we worked on this in a series of steps. So our first step was that we developed a campaign. So we knew that menthol was a huge, going to be a huge lift regulating menthol, and we really wanted to have a strong campaign that talked to particularly the African American community, but also other communities about why this needed to be done and why we need to take a stand against the tobacco industry. So we worked with a local graphic designer, and she helped us come up with this campaign, Beautiful Lie, Ugly Truth About Menthol Tobacco. This designer, she's African American. She was really able to work with us and make sure that we had a campaign that she thought would resonate. And we really wanted to focus, like I said, our messaging around how the tobacco industry has targeted particular communities and how we need to do something about this. So we didn't want to make it, we wanted to make it about the tobacco industry more. So the designer came up with the brilliant idea to take photos of local people. And so these people that you'll see in our materials, they all live in this area, and that was amazing. People would constantly tell us, oh, I know so-and-so, and people felt really connected to the campaign. Here's our fact sheet. So we tried to show the statistics, but we also tried to talk about the tobacco industry. So this is the front. But then on the back, we really talk about how the tobacco industry has a long history of targeting certain communities, and that's why these communities use menthol at high rates. And we would always include, tobacco industry quotes. We also had the opportunity to work with a local spoken word artist, and he wrote a poem about our campaign, and we made a video using a lot of local people as well. So I'm going to play that video for you.
Ever since it's been around, just a spoonful of menthol helps the poison go down.
Smoke-related illness is killing us, disproportionately black men and youth.
Far surpassing any other drug, disease, or car crashes. And it's no accident.
The ashtray leads to our ashes.
Sin embargo, esa no es la historia que ustedes nos cuentan. Ustedes, con sus anuncios, disfrazan el sabor de la muerte. Ustedes no nos dicen las tasas de la mortalidad. Tampoco nos dicen lo que vamos a pagar, la deuda, por cada aliento.
You're betting on us to ignore the Surgeon General's warning.
You improve profit margins when you profit up those in the margins, making us think you're our friends by giving us a bargain.
Like a van, parked out on the corner giving away free sample cartons.
It's all addictive, and menthol makes quitting even harder.
It's disgusting to see how you focus your campaign on the young, black, and dumb.
That's the way you described us, saying, the younger the better. Black lungs don't matter, as long as our pockets get fatter. We don't smoke it, so it don't matter.
We're not buying these lies you're telling us. It's all just smoke, you're blowing us.
RJ Reynolds said he'd never smoke it, but he's selling it to us. Sponsoring our favorite concerts, movies, and magazines. But we're here to tell you that we're on to your scheme. We see the ugly truths behind the smoke screen, the beautiful lies that we won't believe.
Stop selling us these beautiful lies and ugly truths.
Cause we ain't buying them.
Cause we ain't buying them.
Cause we ain't buying them.
Cause I ain't buying them.
So the video, we were able to make a shorter version, and we were able to use that in a lot of different settings. We shared it with council members, we shared it with the community, and I think the video really made a powerful impact. So the next step, I should say, these aren't exactly linear, so they all work together. They're all going on at the same time, I would say, especially this one. But the next step was really building a coalition, and this was really the bulk of our work, so it may seem a little funny that I only have one slide about it, but this is really where the rubber meets the road. You need a strong coalition, and I think we had a really strong coalition. We had more than 50 organizations signed on, and there was a really heavy focus on African-American groups, faith. It was just extremely diverse, and our coalition partners were really the messengers taking this out into the community and doing a lot of education around this topic. The next step is countering the opposition. So the opposition was extremely fierce. Our executive director here said it's the worst she's seen at the local level, and she's been doing this at least 40 years. They were organized. They had, I think, effective messaging. But I think they came in a little too late. That was the problem. But I'm sure that they will get better. So our opposition was primarily the tobacco companies, most notably Reynolds American. They co-opted kind of African-American leaders. But we also had a lot of retail associations come out against this. We had convenience store chains. And here's kind of an example of the types of things we ran into. Reynolds paid these African-American leaders, including Al Sharpton, to come to Minneapolis and talk about how this policy was going to criminalize black men in particular. We had to come out strongly and say, no, that's not what this is about. This is not going to criminalize anyone. This isn't about criminalizing anyone who's possessing menthol. This is just about saying where these products can be sold. There was a lot of the tobacco industry hired many additional lobbyists, and I think we were able to really work effectively with the press to let to kind of feed the story to the press so that they knew what was going on. And I think we were able to call attention to the fact that these lobbyists, they weren't like local people. These were paid tobacco lobbyists, and I think we were able to shift the message kind of effectively. So the final step is advocating. So Minneapolis has a pretty long and complicated and kind of legislative process. So the policy is introduced in March, we had actually an educational hearing in March with the Health Committee. Then in June, it was formally introduced. That was the beginning of our T-shirt war. You'll see what I mean in a minute. In July, we felt like some of these opposition messages were kind of breaking through, so we did our own press conference with a lot of African-American leaders that called on the city council to do this. Then we had a public hearing in the Health Committee. We had 60-plus testifiers, and we actually lost quorum because it went on so long. So we had to have another meeting of the health committee, and then we had a final vote. So it was a long process. It was drawn out, and it was tiring because we had so much opposition. Here's our T-shirt war. We were the green T-shirts. They were the reddish orange. We had a lot of really great testifiers. Young people were so inspiring. We had African-American leaders. We had, you name it, they were there, 60-plus people. It was really an amazing day. These are all the people that wouldn't fit into the chambers who are out in the hall. And finally, I'm so glad we got to step five, which is celebrate. Here's one of our city council champions coming out after the final vote. We were all so happy. And here we are with both of our city council champions on the city hall steps. And that was just truly a really fantastic day for all of us. So the final step, the one we're on now, is implementing and evaluating. It's not implemented yet, but the city's preparing materials. They're doing outreach. We're helping where we can. And there's really a robust evaluation plan going on. There's a lot of different components to it, and I think we'll be able to say a lot of things about this policy in the short-term future, hopefully. So here are kind of our key lessons. I think obviously community engagement, youth involvement was really essential. I think I learned never underestimate the opposition. They'll go really far. They'll take it really far. Check in with your council champions often. We warned them that it was going to be fierce opposition, but I don't think any of us really understood. So just make sure you're supporting your champions. And then make sure you have really good messaging. I think that helped us. Here's our contact information. If you want to know more, please reach out to us. We would love to share this story with anyone who wants to hear more.
Great. Thank you so much, Betsy. Thanks for all of that information on your really well-planned campaign, and congratulations. Next, I'm happy to introduce Michael Scott for an overview of the social context on menthol tobacco use. Michael currently serves as the network coordinator at NAATPN. He has been involved in tobacco use prevention and public health for the past 15 years. So thank you so much, Michael, for being with us this afternoon.
Thank you. You're welcome. And I just want to thank Josh for being able to adjust the agenda for my schedule. I just landed, got home, and I am here and ready to roll. And I know originally I was slated to go first, which probably would have made more sense, because now I think that some of these slides may be repeats, but I think there's still a lot of new information that people can appreciate. So again, I'm Michael Scott, network coordinator with NAATPN Inc., formerly the National African American Tobacco Prevention Network. And we'll be talking, I want to talk a little bit about the social context of menthol and menthol cigarettes. And when we talk about the social context, we're talking about an individual's immediate social and physical environment, the people and institutions that they interact with, and their overall culture, in which you'll see menthol has played a big role. The use of menthol takes into account all of these that I've just listed. So let's just keep it real. When we think of menthol, when people say menthol, we automatically think about Newports, Kools. We automatically think about menthol being the quote-unquote black cigarette. And still to this day, there's still a little underlying belief that menthol is a little bit healthier. And that comes from just the other uses of menthol. And when we talk about the other uses of menthol, we're talking about where we find menthol: Vicks Vapor Rub, cough medicines, cough drops, your tea tree shampoos and conditioners. So
aside from cigarettes, when you think of menthol, you think of, you know, pleasant stuff, candy, things that help you feel better. So there's still a little underlying belief that a menthol cigarette is, or could be, a little bit healthier than a regular cigarette. And I know that I'm sure folks have already talked about the targeted marketing, so I'll just briefly talk about it, because we're all well aware of the targeted marketing towards African Americans and other communities, but specifically African Americans were and are targeted by the tobacco industry to use these menthol products and youth. And I've got a slide a little bit later down the line that talks about the youth component of menthol use. And when we look at the skyrocketing use of menthol over the last 50 or 60 years, if we go back to the 1950s, you know, African-American use of menthol was only at about 5%. And then as we, you know, go up another 15 years, it's tripled. You know, another almost 10 years, it's tripled again. Then it's doubled to where we are now, where it's probably closer to 90% of African-Americans that use menthol tobacco products. And then when we look at the incidence rates for cancers and who suffers the most from cancer, African-Americans. So we can see that connection between menthol use and cancer incidence. And it's not just African-Americans. And I think somebody else mentioned this earlier. I jumped on the call a little bit late, but we're looking at African-American youth at 88%, Asians at about 51%, Latinos 47%, LGBTQ 36%. And as the last presenter said, when you look at LGBT youth, it's at 70%. And then, of course, when we look at white folks, there's still 30%. That's still a good number. But when we look at those numbers, we're seeing that the folks that are being targeted by this product are the same folks that the CDC is targeting as far as funding opportunities to reduce tobacco use and incidence of cancer in those specific populations. So the CDC realizes that, hey, we've got a select amount of specific populations that are suffering disproportionately from tobacco use. And when we look at some of those groups, there's eight groups that are considered priority populations that the CDC is currently funding. And African-Americans, Asians, Latinos, LGBTQ are in that eight. And when we look at menthol use, those folks are in the top four, which takes us back to the Family Smoking and Protection Act, where that banned flavors a few years ago. I'm kind of jumping ahead, so let me not jump ahead to that slide yet. But socially, we look at cigarette use, smoking. The smoking rates are going down, you know, and we all deserve a hand for that. But then when you look at menthol use is slowly creeping up. So while we're seeing a consistent decline in regular use, menthol use is actually increasing. And then when we look at, you know, your environment and how you get your cigarettes, we know that menthol cigarettes are cheaper in African-American communities. They're cheaper in low-income communities. Where else can you go and get a Lucy? You know, you can get one. You can't afford a pack. You go to the corner store, and you get a Lucy. And 10 times out of 10, when you ask for a Lucy, you're going to get handed a Newport. We look at African-American teens, menthol use. Asian teens, Hispanic, and even white teens, menthol use is skyrocketing. It's not decreasing. And again, the Family Smoking and Prevention Control Act banned flavors except menthol. And then by allowing that menthol exception, you know, we're looking at the poorest, the least informed, the folks with the fewest resources not receiving that same level of protection that banning the flavors did, because these folks are using menthol, which they allowed to keep. So we need to look at menthol also as a social justice issue. And we talked a little bit about, folks already talked about the movement to ban menthol, so I'll just breeze by that real quick. We have had some success, so it is possible to get some of these laws passed. We talked about the folks pushing back on menthol. And one of the main events that NAATPN likes to promote is our yearly No Menthol Sunday event, which is coming up in about 3 weeks. It's a national observance that we lead, that we give the opportunity for faith leaders to engage their communities in discussions about menthol and tobacco use. Our website for that event is nomentholsunday.org. It's not too late to participate. If you go to that website, you can download a tool guide, a toolkit that will provide the churches everything they need to participate in this event. And I know I was running a little bit fast, but I didn't want to take up too much time. And if there's any questions, feel free to come to our website or to get my email and shoot me an email. If there's any questions, I guess we'll take the questions during the question and answer period.
Excellent. Yeah, thank you so much, Michael, for your presentation. Thank you for joining us this afternoon. And thanks again to all of our other speakers for joining this afternoon as well, Laura and Betsy. So we do have time on our agenda for questions and answers. And so I will be moderating today's Q&A session by directing inquiries from you all joining us this afternoon from the chat box to today's speakers. And as a reminder, phone and computer microphones are muted for the duration of our webinar this afternoon. So if you do have a follow-up question or a clarifying question during our Q&A time here, please continue to use the chat box to submit inquiries as we address questions. So before I turn things over to our speakers joining us, I'll make a reminder announcement that we will be making webinar slides and a recording of our webinar this afternoon available to all registrants via email early next week, and then we'll also have those materials available on the resources tab of the TCN website later on, probably in a week or two. So to get started by addressing some questions that we've had in the chat box, we have someone joining us who wrote in, I don't hear much of Al Sharpton making accusations that menthol bans are racist against African Americans or of staging town hall meetings to rally opposition to menthol bans. Has this tactic by Reynolds American seized? I know this is something that was touched upon by both Michael and Betsy. Michael, do you have any insights as to whether this tactic by Reynolds and by Reverend Sharpton has no longer been continuing in recent years?
As far as I know, there haven't been any recent community forums. I'm not sure if they've completely stopped them, but like the question said, they are they have occurred, and they actually started occurring under the guise of criminalization of the African-American male in the black community. They didn't mention menthol cigarettes at all until folks got there. So it was, you know, of course, again, with tobacco industry, this is another underhanded way of, you know, trying to get their message across. But once folks confronted them at these community meetings and said, hey, look, this is being funded by Reynolds American, you know, but no, I haven't heard of any new ones. But that doesn't mean that they're not happening. They usually don't pop up on the radar until the very last minute.
Terrific. Yeah, thank you, Michael, for that insight. Betsy, do you have anything to add to that?
Sharpton himself, I think, has distanced himself a little bit, but the other presenters, I'm not going to remember their names off the top of my head, but there's one guy that's with the National Organization of Black Law Enforcement, Noble, and then there's a former congressman. They've been back. They came back to St. Paul, and you know, their whole thing is about how these are going to criminalize black men. And obviously that's something that a lot of us are worried about and a lot of us are scared about. So, you know, that's definitely a hot button issue that gets people like paying attention. So we heard that they met with some black law enforcement here in St. Paul. So I think they may be doing more than Sharpton is at this point.
Understood. Yeah, thank you, Betsy, for your insight there. Another question I'd like to pose to the group. Someone wrote in, some of our work with faith-based organizations, we have found that folks don't want to admit that they smoke and that they don't smoke at church, but that they do smoke outside of church. Michael, I might turn that over to you in reference specifically to No Menthol Sunday. Do you have any additional context or insight on that phenomenon? Is that something that you're seeing with your No Menthol Sunday initiative?
Yes. Yeah, we definitely see that. We definitely hear that story. And matter of fact, last year we chose a theme for No Menthol Sunday, which was kind of, I forget the exact wording of it, but it was like kind of like coming out of the closet about your tobacco use and just realizing that, you know, a lot of folks don't admit to smoking, especially in the faith-based community. So what we do with our faith-based, with our No Menthol Sunday effort is we incorporate, you know, it may not be you that's smoking, but maybe there's a family member that's smoking. Maybe you're being exposed to secondhand smoke. So we try to pull in the body as a temple and protecting your family and your loved ones, because in the faith community, we do see that a lot. But then when you look at the numbers, I mean, those folks, they're definitely smoking, but again, they're not admitting it to folks in the church. So, you know, that becomes a struggle when you're trying to promote anti-smoking efforts in the church, because then the church is like, oh, we don't have a smoking problem. But the reality of it is that you probably do, but it's just not being talked about. People aren't doing it out in the open. So when doing something with the faith-based community, you know, you've got to incorporate, you know, the message being not just about the individual, but about how, you know, spreading that information is going to help the folks that aren't in the church. So you may be in the church not smoking, but, you know, maybe your grandfather, your father, your aunt or uncle who doesn't go to church but sits home all day and is, you know, smoking around your family, you know, you can spread that message back to them. So it's got to be more, instead of individualized, make it so it's almost like a train-the-trainer where you can give information that's easy enough that they can bring back to their families and their friends that aren't in the, may not be in the faith community.
Terrific. Yeah, thank you, Michael, for those insights. Have a question that I would like to pose to Laura. Laura, someone is wondering about Alaska Natives and American Indians and their rate of menthol use. Do you have any insights based on your data from the state of Minnesota to indicate how that population's use of menthol tobacco products might relate to the general public or to the African American communities in Minnesota?
Our American Indian rate is very high. We did a specialized survey beyond the BRFIS, and the adult smoking rate is at 59%. I don't know what the breakdown is related to menthol and non-menthol. I think anecdotally we hear it's high, but I don't know the percentage. But it is, obviously in that population, it is a very we have a high level of concern.
Understood. Thanks, Laura. We have a question that I'd like to pose to Betsy from the local coalition perspective. Betsy, have there been any lawsuits or threats of lawsuits since the passage of some of those no menthol policies that you alluded to in local jurisdictions in Minnesota?
Not yet. One of our council members is really excited about Tobacco 21, and we're actually working with him on it right now. And we were a little worried that may kind of open the door again to maybe changes to the menthol policy, and we even heard a few rumblings from some of the new council members. As I mentioned, we have a whole new council, well, not a whole new council, but we had all the council members were up for election. So there was some fear at first, but I think, we thought some of the store owners might use that as a way to say, well, just get rid of this menthol thing and do T21. And they definitely are saying that, but it doesn't seem like it's getting a lot of traction with the council. In fact, several council members told us, like, oh, no, I don't want to talk about menthol again. Like, I think it was somewhat unpleasant for them just how much opposition it was facing. So a lot of the council members are saying, oh, no, we don't want to talk about that again. So it seems like it's going to be implemented. It doesn't seem like it'll be rolled back or anything, and we haven't heard any threats of lawsuit. And I'm knocking on wood.
Understood, Betsy. I'll join you in knocking on wood as well. That makes sense. We have a question I'd like to pose to Michael. Michael, someone's wondering what strategies have folks used to discredit Al Sharpton and those other prominent community figures in the African American community in terms of the public presentations they were making about African American?
Yeah, that's a good question because we do hear that a lot. So as one of the other speakers mentioned, the law as it's proposed is not a ban on possession, but on the sale of menthol cigarettes. So law enforcement in any of these districts are not being trained to spot, menthol cigarettes. You know, it's not about the possession or the use or, smoking them. It's about the sale of the product from the retail side. So, again, in these community forums, we provide folks there that actually, stand up and say, hey, it's not about that. The police can't do that. That's not how it works. But of course, the level of concern is still going to be there because, especially in this day and time with the relations between, colored communities of people of color and the police is not very good right now. It has to be something that we talk about. But again, it's not the way these bans are written. It is not, they do not allow for the possession of the product of a menthol cigarette to be, it's not legal for them to accost you for smoking or possessing it. It's all about the sale of the product on the retail end.
Terrific. Yeah, thank you, Michael, for spelling that out for us. That certainly makes sense. We have a question that I'd like to pose to Laura and perhaps to Betsy as well after hearing from Laura. Someone's writing that preemption in Wisconsin, which I know is the case for several other states as well, prevents local folks in Wisconsin from passing local ordinances and policies that might restrict the sale of menthol tobacco products. So, Laura, what suggestions might you have on what folks in Wisconsin can do to move the needle at the state level on this issue in terms of doing something perhaps outside of policy to address menthol use in various communities within a given state?
You know, one of the most effective tools or strategies that our African American Leadership Forum used is the presentations of the findings from the survey I mentioned back to the community. So the change agents were charged with going in and educating and mobilizing the community, and to share the stories and the impact was, I think, was very effective. The other thing the coalition did at the local level was have a press conference just to talk about the harm and the prevalence of the impact of menthol tobacco. And there I was really impacted, and so was the audience, and the press was quite good, talking about the chronic disease and the death that touched so many of the community members directly a result from menthol tobacco use. So I would recommend that, and I'm sure Betsy has many other ideas.
Well, I would echo that, and I would say I think what worked well for us was we came up with a kind of a presentation, and it really outlined how we looked through, just lots of tobacco company documents, and we found some really egregious examples of how they had targeted, especially the African American community. There was one document we found where they talked about how they were going to go to check cashing and public housing, and there, I think there were like three other settings, and they were going to, give out free coupons or free cigarettes, menthol cigarettes. And so we found a lot of those types of really egregious ways that the tobacco industry had targeted communities. And then our coalition members went out and educated the community, and it was amazing. I saw it more than once. People would sort of be shocked, and they would say, well, yeah, I remember that, and you're right. They really did specifically target my community. Like, they never thought about it in that sort of way, and just the sort of like the light bulb moments. And people would get very angry, and they would say, we need to just tell everyone else about this. So I think that's one part of it, you know, just at least educating the community on this, how this has been done.
Terrific. Yeah, thank you, Laura, and thank you, Betsy, for your insights there. And thank you, Michael, for your contributions to our Q&A as well. Unfortunately, that is about the time that we have for Q&A. So thank you for everyone's responses. And I hope the Q&A was helpful in shedding additional light on how state and local stakeholders can move the needle forward, specifically on menthol tobacco use. So at this point, I would like to turn things back over to my co-moderator, Aaron, to provide a brief overview of menthol tobacco resources from national partners and also describe what's currently available for folks on the TCN website.
Thanks, Josh. The Public Health Law Center has a comprehensive toolkit for state and local public health stakeholders to reference in crafting policies to prohibit the sale of menthol tobacco products, and a history of the federal government's involvement in menthol tobacco products. The Truth Initiative has a comprehensive infographic on menthol tobacco use, which can be used to help communicate the burdens of menthol tobacco as a health equity issue to partners and stakeholders. And Campaign for Tobacco-Free Kids has published comprehensive resources that overview the health burdens of menthol tobacco use, again, from a health equity lens. And all of these hyperlinks are resources are freely available online and linked directly to these web pages will be made available as part of the slides from this afternoon's webinar. I also want to provide everyone a reminder of the public comment periods that are currently open as a result of FDA-issued advance notices for proposed rulemaking. One of these open comment periods requests data, research, and information on flavorings in tobacco products with menthol explicitly included. As of 2009, FDA does have the legal authority to ban menthol tobacco products nationwide if they decide to do so. And the public comment period is open until June 19th for those who are interested in submitting a comment to the Federal Register. And finally, I want to provide a brief overview of the tobacco resources available on the TCN website, www.tobaccocontrolnetwork.org. The TCN website offers ample resources designed specifically for state and territorial tobacco control programs and their partners, including an archive of TCN's twice-monthly newsletter, a directory of all TCN members across the United States and territories, an updated resources listing of blog posts, webinars, and podcast recordings, and the 2016 policy recommendations document, which provides a comprehensive overview of the tobacco control policy best practices that can be enacted at state and local levels. Be on the lookout for an interactive state policy map to be fully launched on the TCN website soon. A notice of this resource will be circulated through the TCN mailing list. And if you have any questions about these resources or would like to join the TCN mailing list, reach out to TCN@asto.org. So thank you. This has been such a fantastic webinar with great information shared. I'll turn things over now to Josh for a brief highlight of ASTO tobacco resources and some concluding remarks.
Thank you so much, Aaron, and I will absolutely, of course, echo that sentiment. So just to let folks know about what's available on the ASTO website. The ASTO webpage also contains a plethora of tobacco control resources for states and territories and the local folks that they work with. I want to briefly highlight the newly updated listing of ASTO tobacco blog posts. This listing includes a blog post on menthol cigarettes as a health disparities issue, as well as a comprehensive overview of the recent FDA rulemaking notices that Aaron made mention of, with some information on how specifically states can get involved in that comment period process. The S website also has available several recent virtual event recordings on the tobacco webinars archive page on the ASTO website. Both of those hyperlinks are available on screen and will be circulated to everybody through slides in the coming weeks. I also want to remind everybody of ASTO's interactive infographic that explores how state health departments can address tobacco-related disparities in promoting health equity. ASTO launched this resource collaboratively with 8 CDC-funded national networks that work with populations experiencing disproportionate disease and death burdens that result from tobacco use, including NAATPN Inc., who's joining us this afternoon. And ASTO invites everybody to view this interactive infographic via the ASTO website or the direct hyperlink below to gain an improved understanding of tobacco-related health disparities in the United States. As we wrap up, I would like to let everyone know you will be directed to a survey at the conclusion of this webinar, and a link to the survey will also be made available to folks joining us this afternoon via follow-up email. Please, if you're able to, take a few minutes to complete this survey, as it provides TCN with invaluable input on how we can improve future webinars and future virtual learning opportunities. And so that does conclude this afternoon's webinar, so I would like to take one final opportunity to thank Laura Oliven, Betsy Brock, and Michael Scott for joining us this afternoon. I'd also like to thank everyone from ASTO and from the Tobacco Control Network who contributed to today's webinar, including my co-moderator, Aaron Bowles-Welsh. Again, a recording of today's webinar will be sent to everybody via email early next week and will also be made available on the TCN website. And of course, any at all inquiries about Tobacco Control Network, or if you want to join the TCN mailing list, all of those inquiries can be sent to us at tcn@asto.org. Thank you, everyone, for joining us, and please enjoy the rest of your day.